Welcome and good morning, everybody. Good morning. We're glad you chose to worship with us here today at Central Community Church of God's online worship service. We hope and trust that you will enjoy the service and you are encouraged in the Lord through this service itself. My name is Malcolm Bolick, and I'm honored and blessed to be called pastor of this awesome congregation here in Hanford, California. While there are times that we're encouraged as a result of things that have worked out to our advantage, or even the kind words of a family member or a friend, do you know that we must always also encourage ourselves in the Lord as well? Did you know that? The psalmist wrote these words in Psalm 103, verse 2. He says, "Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things He does for me." In a sense, it was like the psalmist was talking to himself. Not that any of us would ever do something like that, right? We don't talk to ourselves well. I know I do. But if we ever did, one of the greatest things we could tell ourselves is, "Praise the Lord, may I never forget the good things He does for me." You know, if you take a little time today, you just count the blessings in your life, it won't take long to have a spirit of appreciation, which would lead to an attitude of praise to the Lord for His blessings. If you have a few moments before this service or even during the service, why not reflect on His blessings? And I promise you, you will be encouraged in the Lord. Let's pray. Lord of heaven, Lord of earth, we thank you, Lord, for the blessings of life and health. Thank you for allowing us to have the opportunity to be in your presence this morning. Lord, we come together with the unity of our faith and ask that everything we bind be bound in heaven. Allow everything we loose be loosed in heaven. Together we will combat the evil that gathers and ask all the evildoers just be confounded, and may their plans always come to naught. Lord, bless us so that we may leave here this morning with your spiritual blessings, and allow us now to glorify your name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hey folks, I'm a morning person, but I wouldn't go far as to say that I'm a really early morning person. Yet I find that the early hours of the day really offer a peace and a stillness that's conducive to meeting and hearing from God. During my devotions, early is a sure way to put God first in my day. On those mornings that I acknowledge God, from the moment I place my feet on the floor, my day is different. I deal with temptation differently. I respond to difficulty differently. I engage with God throughout the day differently. See, setting aside early morning time for personal devotions lets me dedicate the whole rest of the day to God. And it can help you do the same. See, you have to give God your unhurried time. Making time for personal devotions and getting into the habit of daily devotions are perennial challenges for any follower of Jesus. If the morning is the time you feel most with it and energized, then that's the time to give it to God. It's easy to make personal devotions just another to-do list on your item. Okay, I got to read so many chapters in the Bible, pray for at least this long, and write this much in my journal. However, folks, it's important to remember that devotions are more about purpose than a specific process. Romans 14, verses 1 through 9 suggests that the mode of personal devotions is really a matter of conviction. It says this: accept other believers who are weak in faith and don't argue with them about what they think is right or wrong. For instance, one person believes it's all right to eat anything, but another believer with a sensitive conscience will only eat vegetables. Those who feel free to eat anything must not look down at those who don't. And those who don't eat certain foods must not condemn those who do, for God has accepted them. Who are you to condemn someone else's servants? Their own master will judge whether they stand or fall, and with the Lord's help, they will stand and receive his approval. In the same way, some think one day is more holy than another day, while others think every day is alike. You should each be fully convinced that whichever day you choose is acceptable. Those who worship the Lord on a special day do it so to honor him. Those who eat any kind of food do it so to honor the Lord, since they give thanks to God before eating. And those who refuse to eat certain foods also want to please the Lord and give thanks to God. For we don't live for ourselves or die for ourselves. If we live, it's to honor the Lord. And if we die, it's to honor the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Christ died and rose again for this very purpose, to be Lord both of the living and of the dead. You see, what might work well for one person may not suit another. The point of devotions is not to be part of a checkoff list, but the point is to be with God. You see, devotions are about inviting God's presence into your day. You might sit quietly with a steaming cup of coffee to watch the sunrise, sharing that experience with God. Perhaps you choose to wake up by reading a spiritually evocative book. And if so, ask God to join you and enlighten you. Maybe the quietness of your pre-sunrise household allows you to better heed the Spirit's leading as you read God's Word. And if you need some structure, a daily devotion can help you get into God's Word. It really can, folks. It helps you reflect on the presence in your day-to-day life, and it then will lead you into prayer. And lastly, don't rush. Let your morning devotions take as long as is needed to encounter your Savior. And then let God take the lead. While a habit of daily devotions is good, it's more important to let God take the lead each and every time. See, habits can become so, habitual. We just want to do the same thing again and again, as though we're following an unalterable formula. We lose sight of the purpose to actually spend time with God. When we ask God to direct our devotions each morning, we give God the lead to set a whole different tone for the day ahead. If you're anything like me, The issues confronting the day riot through your mind from the first moment you wake. That noise of the day really hinders our ability to put the Lord first. Some sound advice I've heard before is to write down the thoughts that are cluttering your mind and then lift them in prayer. This way I surrender the agenda and my mind space to God. When we let God set the agenda, in those moments, His agenda becomes the foundation for the day. The early morning devotional time lets you get ahead of everything else and allows you to submit it all to the Lord. Early in the morning devotions give you the chance to turn the whole day over to the Lord. And if you're a morning person, you can give your best energy, even if you don't care much for the morning. Acknowledging God first thing and asking Him what He wants to do equips you to deal with the day's challenges on just a more solid footing. Think about those things. Let's pray. Father God, we admit that we've reached a point in our spiritual journey with You where we may have grown complacent. We find ourselves, Lord, not longing to pray or to read our Bibles. We've not been very consistent with fellowshipping with other believers. Help us get rid of these distractions in our lives, Lord, that may have kept us from kingdom pursuits. Social media and other entertainment can very quickly become a spiritual junk food that does not truly nourish our souls. Lord, will You help us prioritize these things in our lives so that You are primary? Help us to see the things or people in our lives that may be keeping us from growing in our relationship with You, Lord. Strip away our comforts, our pleasures, and our pride, and make us hungry for You and Your righteousness. Lord, fill us up with Your abundant life. We want to pursue You. We want to praise You and read Your word consistently. Lord, we want to stay committed to our local church, learn of Your ways, and learn about You. We know we need Your help to stay on that narrow path. So help us, Lord. This is our prayer this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
Here I see me. Something's broken, I need your help. I can't fix this on my own. My heart is prone to wander far, but you call me back to your arms, and I fall at your feet again. Here's my heart again, Lord, I am yours. And I run with my chains undone, all because the love that you have shown. When I hear mercy calling, it's at your feet I'm falling. Oh, Jesus, I surrender all. I surrender all to you, yes. Cause your kindness leads me to the light. No fear, no shame, I can't hide. You bore the nails and you wore the scars. Now I am safe in your arms. Oh, and I fall at your feet again. Here's my heart again, Lord, I am yours. And I run with my chains undone, all because the love that you have shown. When I hear mercy calling, it's at your feet I'm falling. Oh, Jesus, I surrender all. You deserve it all. I surrender all. To Jesus, I surrender humbly at your feet. I bow, and these earthly treasures, all forsaken, here's my life. I lay it down. Oh, to Jesus, I surrender humbly at your feet. I bow, and these earthly treasures, all forsaken, here's my life. I lay it down. Oh, and I fall at your feet again. Here's my heart again, Lord, I am yours. And I run with my chains undone, all because the love that you have shown. Oh, and when I hear mercy calling, it's at your feet I'm falling. Oh, Jesus, I surrender all. Oh, Jesus, I surrender.
Hey folks, welcome back to our third part of Bless the Beatitudes. And today we're going to talk about no weakness in meekness. You know, the story is told of one day of a young Benjamin Franklin that he made a surprise visit to the home of a man named Cotton Mather. As Franklin was leaving, Mather shouted at him, "Stoop! Stoop!" But it was too late. Franklin had struck his head on the low door frame. Mather said to Franklin, "You are young and have the world before you. Stoop as you go through it, and you will miss many hard thumps." And later Franklin wrote, "I often think of Mather's words when I see pride mortified and misfortunes brought upon people by carrying their heads just a little too high." We too need to stoop through life. We must be a people willing to stoop, willing to be humble, okay? Romans 12 verse 3 says, "Because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith that God has given us." In 1 Peter 5 verse 5, it says, "In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders. And all of you dress yourselves in humility as you relate to one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." See, Christians view meekness quite differently than does the world. The world takes meekness as being weak, or as they say, meekness is weakness, allowing individuals to just walk all over you. However, true meekness is found in strength rather than weakness. John Milton referred to the invisible might of meekness. In Galatians 3:5, 22-23, as I read here, it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law." He's saying here that gentleness is part of fruit of the Spirit. Paul, the Apostle Paul, inspired of the Spirit, writes that the Spirit produces gentleness in our lives. But Paul wasn't a man you walked all over. No way. When Paul withstood Peter to his faith, I doubt that Peter would have said that you could walk all over Paul. It says this in Galatians 2:11-14. "When Cephas," Peter, "came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to his circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in front of them all, 'You are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs?'" See, when Paul offered to come to the Corinthians with a rod in 1 Corinthians 4:21, I seriously doubt the Corinthians would have said that they could walk over Paul either. In 1 Corinthians 4:21, it says, "What do you prefer? Shall I come to you with a rod of discipline, or shall I come in love with a gentle spirit?" Numbers 12, verse 3 says, "And now Moses was a very humble man, more humble than anyone else in the face of the earth." See, while Moses here was the meekest man on the face of the earth, it certainly wasn't the case that you can go walk all over Moses. The morning the Pharaoh awoke to find his firstborn son dead, I seriously doubt that Pharaoh would have said that he could walk all over Moses. See, the Lord Jesus spoke the words we're studying this morning. But you don't walk all over Jesus. When Jesus entered the temple and cleansed it, I doubt the money changers would have said that Jesus could be walked all over. When Jesus referred to the scribes and Pharisees as hypocrites, none of them would have said that Jesus could be walked all over. This third beatitude deals with this humility. It says, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." And this morning, we want to examine this beatitude in detail. We want to hear these words of Jesus as they call us to be meek people. I have a verse up above my head here, and it comes from Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 2. And it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded," that's you and me, "by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down." The Hebrew writer says this, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. Ah, see, the sin that has your name on it. I call it your signature sin. I think we all have one. Oh, yours may be different than mine. I'm sure it is. But what I struggle with may be different from yours. But all of us have this sin that so easily trips us up, doesn't it? And we need to get past that. We need to get past it. But how do we get past it? How do we get past that? As Paul says here, how do we run with endurance the race that God has set before us? How do we get past? It says in the second verse, it says, why we do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith because of the joy awaiting him. He endured the cross regarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. You see, how do we make our way through this life? How do we go through all the trials, all the things that come? We keep our eyes on Jesus. As the verse says, we're talking about hurts and hang-ups in our lives, right? All the hurts and hang-ups that are in our lives. This is what we're talking about. We're looking at the Beatitudes, how God sees us as blessed. They appear in Matthew 5, verses 3 through 12. With Matthew 5 and 6 and 7, it's all part of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' most famous and often quoted sermon. The Magna Carta, if you would, of the Christian faith in which we stand, the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus says to follow, live your life like this. Follow these principles, these ideals, and you will have a life and a life abundant. And it begins with the Beatitudes. See, the Beatitudes are 8 qualities that Jesus lays out right at the beginning of his sermon. The first 4 have to do with what we believe and how we come to God and see ourselves before our Creator. The last 4 have to do with behavior due to how we see ourselves. And then how do we respond? Week 1, we said it begins with when Jesus says this in verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. See, our relationship begins right there. We can't progress until we realize that we are broken people with empty hands. And then last week, we read the second Beatitude in verse 4, which says, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. See, mourning here is mourning over our sin. Folks, remember that. It's mourning over our sin, mourning over the sin of the world, mourning over the fact that sin has broken and severed our relationship with God. When we recognize who we are before God, when we mourn over that sin, we come to our third Beatitude this week in Matthew 5, verse 5. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. The New Living Translation says, God blesses those who are humble. Humble. See, now that word meek, that word humble, that's not a word like that we use a lot in our language very much, is it? I looked it up a little bit in the thesaurus, and I wrote it down. Here's some of the words that are associated with the word meek or the word humble. It has to do with maybe a person who's docile or mild or tame or soft, passive or spineless. With that kind of definition, who wants to be meek? Who wants to be humble? Of course, that isn't the word that Jesus is using here. That isn't the word that he wants us to be spineless or like a wet doormat. No, folks, no, no. Jesus is talking about a different kind of meek, a different kind of word, a word where we have strength under control. He says, blessed are the meek. The Greek word there is a word called praos. It has to do with a couple of different things. It's used to describe a cool breeze that comes in the morning or a gentle ointment that you put on your burning skin. A few months ago, we had gone to the coast. Hadn't been there for a while, so I foolishly didn't use any suntan lotion or didn't wear a hat. Yeah, look at my hair. There is none, right? I didn't wear a hat. So my head got rather red. So it's burning, right? And you could put a soothing product on there to make it feel better. That's what I'm talking about. Cool it down. But also in Greek, this is interesting. The word is used to describe strength under control. Think of a wild horse, for example. He has all that strength, but he is untamed. And he's just doing whatever he wants, going wherever he wants to go. But once he brings that strength under control, wow, man, he can be used for so many productive things. He's still strong. He still has power. But now his strength is under control. You see, what Jesus is telling us is this. My broken condition is a result of my life living under my control. Under my control. Because I demand control of my life. That's why I'm broken. That's why I'm messed up. That's why I have empty hands. That's why I mourn over my sin, because I demand to have control over my life. Matthew 16:24 says, and Jesus said to his disciples, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross, and follow me. Man, we must surrender our lives, folks. We must just surrender our will, and we must surrender our control to Jesus. That is strength. And that is strength. Oh, we still have that strength, but now we have a strength that's under control. Whose control? Jesus' control. I don't want to give up control of my life to just anybody, right? I don't want to give up control to anyone I can't trust. So who can I trust? Who can I depend on? Who's for me and not against me? Who has promised to always, always be with me? Who has said he will never leave me? Who has demonstrated his love for me is greater than Jesus? Well, nobody has. I will surrender my life to Jesus Christ. Amen? Jesus says when we willingly surrender our life to him, we will be strong. We will have strength under control. We will begin to walk differently. We will begin to walk more and more like Jesus. Amen? Jesus is our ultimate example of what it means to walk differently than the world around us. In Philippians, Paul says this in verses Philippians 2, 5 through 7. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. We're to walk differently. Jesus surrendered his rights, his privileges, his divine authority, and he came to earth. We too, Jesus says, we too surrender your life voluntarily. Must surrender our lives voluntarily and willingly. Paul says in Ephesians this, what does it look like when we surrender? He says in Ephesians 4:2, he says, always be humble and gentle, be patient with each other. And this is what it looks like to be humble. Making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Now I want to go in on that first word always, because I want you to understand that Paul says always there. Some of you are a lot more like me than you think. You're a sometimes person. Sometimes I'm humble, sometimes I'm gentle, but that's not what Scripture says here. The Scripture says, always be humble and gentle. Walk gently. Paul says again in Philippians 4, verse 5, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Well, that's a challenge, right? How are we allowing our gentleness to be evident to all? How are you doing with that? It says there, the Lord is near. He sees everything. How can we walk differently? How can we understand that we have strength under control? How can we walk gently? Well, I have one suggestion for you, all of you. One place to start. I suppose there are many places you can begin to walk gently as you analyze and look at your life and think about how I can bring my life more under control. But I want to suggest to you just one. Because if you're like me, and I think a lot of you are, you get lost and confused when you think of more than one thing at a time. So I'm just going to give you one suggestion. One way that you can begin to walk gently. And you know what that is? For all of you folks, start with your conversations. Start with what comes out of your mouth, your words. Start with how you talk with one another, because words are a powerful, powerful thing. Throughout Scripture, we're told to encourage one another, to build each other up. You know why the word stresses that so much, to help to encourage each other and build each other up? You know why it stresses that? Because we need it. We need it. We need encouragement. We need people to come alongside of us and to remind us, hey, that God's for you. that God is for you. We can begin to be gentle when we do this. We can start right there. May your gentleness be known to all by watching our conversation that we have with our friends, within our families, within our workplaces. Everywhere we go, let's watch our conversation. The word goes on to say this in Colossians 4:6. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Let all of our conversations be gracious. Let all our conversations be attractive. Now, it's easy for you and me. It's easy for us to get caught up in debate and conflict and conversations that are not gentle and that are not kind, especially in this world today. All of us are tempted to jump right in and do that. But God's word is very clear, folks, and here's a great place for us to start to walk gently in our conversations. In fact, today I challenge you. I challenge myself. Say some encouraging words. Send an encouraging note. Do something to encourage one another and build each other up. As you do, you will begin to understand what it means to be meek. Understanding. And it goes on to say this, not only gently, let's walk patiently. James says in James 1:19 says, my dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Now, most of us who are in church have heard, those of you watching have heard that verse over and over and over again. Sometimes the danger of hearing those verses over and over again is they go right over our heads. Well, let's not do that this morning. Let's listen to what James, the brother of Jesus, has to say here. We must all of us as Christ followers, be quick to listen. Listen. See, let's listen first. Slow to speak and slow to get angry. Let's hold off our initial attempts to respond. Sometimes we just want to snap right back, don't we? And how did Jesus respond when people were angry or upset with him? He loved them unconditionally. See, Jesus says, as we recognize our sin before ourselves, as we mourn over that sin, as we seek to become more like him, and we surrender our control, our lives will begin to look like this. We'll walk a little more gently. We'll walk a little more patiently with one another. We'll make allowances for each other. And I can tell you without a doubt, and I need each and every one of you, and all of you listening online as well, to make allowances for me. To make allowances for me. You know why? Because I have a lot of faults. I have a lot of faults. Sometimes you can come to me and sometimes I can respond short or inappropriately. Sometimes it has nothing to do with what you said or anything. It just has to do with what's happening in my life. So we need to make allowances for each other. Well, that doesn't mean we just excuse everyone either. No, I'm not saying that. We make allowances for situations. Forgive anybody who offends you. And here it says, why do we do that? Because God, Jesus, has forgiven us. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. See, as we walk with meekness, as we walk in humility, we're not spineless people anymore. No, in fact, we're just the opposite. We now have the power to stand up against and not be so worried or so consumed with anger and hatred about those who treat us poorly. We now have a different kind of strength, a different kind of power, a different kind of passion. Our own self-interest does not drive it. It's driven by Jesus Christ himself, who even though he was God, gave up all his rights to be God, and he paid the price. Jesus says he has not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for the many. You see, when we look and walk more like Jesus, when we understand humility, we understand meekness, we will begin to look and walk a little bit more like Jesus each day. That's the challenge in this third beatitude. He wants to remind us as they build on one another, one builds on the other. The first one on the second one, the third one on the first and second one, and so forth. Surrender voluntarily. Surrender our lives to God. And then here's what Jesus says happens. For when you do, you'll be blessed, because when you do, you will inherit the earth. Now, what does that mean to inherit the earth? Inherit means to possess. Think back in the Old Testament, God's promised land. It was given to God's people. They would inherit, they would possess the promised land. Well, the promised land for you and I as we walk, of course, is the kingdom of God. This is our promised land. In Matthew, Jesus speaks about the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, over and over and over again. In the voluntary surrender of our life to God's rule and reign in our life, He is supreme. You will inherit the kingdom of God. When you belong to Jesus, you are an heir of everything that He has. Everything. I know. I've read these verses so many times, and it's still mind-boggling to me that I am a joint heir. Everything that Christ has becomes a part of me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I get it. I get some of it now in God's blessing, but more of it later in this world that is yet to come. That inheritance belongs to us. We will inherit the kingdom of God. We will inherit the kingdom of heaven. We will be part of God's rule and reign in our life. And Jesus here is quoting from Psalm 37. I want you to see this. I didn't put the whole verse on the screen up above me because it's a tad too long, but I want you to read it to you. I want you to see, as Jesus was quoting from Psalm 37, what it says about the person who surrenders control, who recognizes their poverty before God, who mourns over the sin and has now surrendered their control. They have strength under control. They have strength under control. The psalmist says this. In the first 9 verses of Psalm 37, he says, "Do not fret because of those who are evil or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord and He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him and He will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways." Do we worry sometimes about that? "When they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret, it only leads to evil. For those who are evil will be destroyed, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land." Man, isn't that a wonderful promise? I mean, that's the psalm that Jesus is quoting. We're going to possess that. In other words, the meek trust the Lord. They take delight in the Lord. They wait expectantly for the Lord. They put their hope in the Lord. That's where my hope is. That's where your hope is, and that's where our hope is. So when the trials and difficulty of this life come, and they will, and they do, we can trust in Jesus' almighty hand. What a wonderful, wonderful promise, folks. Jesus reminds us this is how we build our lives. And do you want that kind of strength? Do you? I do. I do. I want strength under control. Well, not my control, because frankly, I don't trust my own control. Remember that. I don't trust my own control. But strength under God's control, strength under Jesus' control. And then as we build more and more and more, we become more and more like Him. We walk gently through this life. We walk patiently. We make allowances for one another. And we begin to look and sound and act more and more like Jesus. Isn't that a wonderful promise? Isn't that a wonderful assurance of God's goodness in our lives? You know, we're going to sing another song that talks about God's blessings. The song repeats over and over and over His favor, that He is for you, He is not against you. I guess that's what I want you to remember this morning. As we surrender control, and surrendering control is difficult to do. Let's not pretend that it's not. But as we surrender control of our lives, we say, Lord, here it is. It's all yours, Lord. It's all yours. I surrender everything to you. I surrender all. All to Jesus. I surrender all. And when we do that, friends, we have life. We have life. And we inherit the land. We inherit the land. We inherit all that God possesses. Think about those things this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you for the truth of your word. Lord, as we move through life, we want to be more like you. We want to sound and act more like you. Your word here is instructing us and telling us what that looks like and how that begins. So Lord, we have to tell you it's a little bit challenging, a little bit frightening, and maybe a little scary to surrender complete control of our lives so that we no longer are walking and operating in our own wants and desires, and that we surrender them now to you. And that might be a tad frightening, Lord. But we know because of you, because your word assures us, because your word has been demonstrated to us, because we have experienced it in our hearts. Oh, we don't just have blind hope, Lord. We have confident assurance because we know that you are at work in our hearts. So Lord, as the prayer we have for ourselves and for all of those listening to our my voice this morning is that we would surrender everything to you. That we would become meek and humble and inherit the earth. So thank you, God, for the hope that you give us. Thank you, God, for the assurance that you give us. And thank you, God, for the life that you give us. Thank you for the truth. And may we always remember, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey guys, before we close today, I want to remind you of a Thursday night's Zoom Bible study and fellowship night. Bring your prayers with you, but also bring your Bibles with you. Come and join us at 6:30 p.m. Everybody is welcome. We'd like you to join us. We would love for you to join us. It's just a low-key Bible study. Bring your Bibles with you, although we'll have all the scriptures on screen, and your questions with you. Bring a notebook if you want, and feel free to ask any question you like. There's no question that's wrong. Ask the question you want. But see, the thing is, you also have to come with an open mind and open heart. We're not here to debate with each other. We're here to help each other. Okay? Remember that. We always remember that. So we'd love for you to join us 6:30 p.m. every Thursday night on Zoom. The Zoom app is free. You get it, and you put down the room number, which I have above my head right now on your screens. Okay, you type in that room number, and then you'll be admitted into our room, and I'll welcome you, and I'll introduce you to all the other people that are in our room. Okay, and we'd love to have you join us. It's a great time. It's a really great time, 6:30 p.m. till around 8 p.m. Pacific time. We'd love for you to join us. Also, don't forget, 10 a.m. every Sunday morning, we come here to church, 1100 North Reddington Street here in Hanford, California. We would love for you to come here and worship God with us as a church family. Worship God with us. This church has been around a long time, over 120 years, and it's struggled the last few years, especially with COVID and everything. And people have, and as most churches have throughout the land, attendance is down. Whether people are afraid to go back to church or not, I don't know, or they think they don't need it, and they do. You'll find out later in life they will. They will have missed it. And so come back to church. And we're waiting. The doors are wide open for everybody to walk in through those doors. And you're welcome to join us. 10 o'clock every Sunday morning, 1100 North Reddington Street. Come and join us. I would love to say hey to you. And let's pray together. Let's sing together. Okay? Every Sunday morning. Guys, before we close in prayer, I want to put up a prayer of healing and blessing and concern to those people that are just struggling right now. We have so many friends of ours that are having health concerns, and we're going to pray for them. We're going to pray for Pat and Pam and Doris and Arlene and Brother Randy and Corey and Cindy up in Victoria and my family in Canada, and just others that church family, friends. And we also want to pray for encouragement in people's hearts that just seem to want to stay away from church right now. Pour encouragement on them to say, whatever, if it isn't this church, find a church to go to and pray with them. And we sing with them. That's what we're going to pray about that as well. So join us now as we close in prayer. Lord Jesus, our hearts melt when we remember that you took the punishment that brought us completeness, that restored soundness to our souls and bodies and flooded us with abundant health. Lord, by the scourging that you received, we're healed. We are cured of all disorders and diseases. We claim this healing, which you purchased at such an awful price for all of our precious friends that are suffering right now. Lord, we pray that you raise them up to their full health. Loving Father, we intercede for those friends who are enduring this pain and suffering. Help our dear brothers and sisters be strong in you and in the power of your might. Help them remember that all things are possible for the one who believes in you. And Lord, now in the name of Jesus, the name above all names, we ask you to take this pain that they have right now away and heal all disorders or disease or injuries contributing to this pain. And bless them, Lord. Bless them with abundant life. Jesus, our Savior, we ask that you intervene in the midst of all of our problems. Life is so challenging right now, Lord, and we do need you. We need you night and day to comfort us. Show us your ways and give us direction. Bring solutions into our lives that only you can provide. Lord, we are full of worry and dismay. We want that erased. We want these anxious thoughts, this anger. Take these fearful thoughts out of our minds. Take away our stress about everything and force us to lay our problems at your feet, Lord. And Jesus, we need solutions and we can't find them on our own. So please use your powerful, mighty hands to break our chains and bring peace to our hearts and minds. Lord, dear God, we exalt your holy name. And we thank you, Lord God, for purifying our minds and hearts with your word and setting us free from bondage. And we thank you for this good time this morning that you have given us. And help us to find more time to do this again. And may we continue to walk in purity, peace, love, and joy. And let your name be glorified in heaven and earth. And this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Guys, I want to thank you for joining us this week. Brother Randy, hey, brother, I love you. Take care of yourselves. I'll see you on Thursday night. All of you other folks, Corey, Cindy, Pat, Pam, Doris, Arlene, I love you all so much, and I miss you so much. I will be around to visit as soon as I can in the weeks ahead, so be prepared for a phone call. I'll come around and talk to you all. I just love you so much. And all of you who haven't been to church for a while, like I said earlier, come to church. Come to church or find a church. Whatever, guys. But we're here wide open. Doors are wide open to every single person that wants to just pray with us, sing with us, listen to the word together with us, and just have some great fellowship together with some wonderfully beautiful people. And we'd like you to be part of that because we love you that much and God loves you. Have a great week, guys. Have a great, blessed week, and I'll see you next Sunday at 10 a.m. God bless you. Bye-bye now.